Good evening, dear students. Hope all of you are staying safe and doing good. Today, I will talk about the next fungal disease, that is cutaneous mycosis. So this will be the last topic in your medical microbiology syllabus. So it's a very simple disease. We can call it as an infection. So we have very few contents to discuss or to talk about. Introduction, classification, cultural characteristics, pathogenicity, pathogenesis, symptoms, diagnosis, prophylaxis, and treatment. So what exactly is this cutaneous mycosis? We will first see what is this mycosis. Mycosis basically refers to infections caused by fungi. Okay, so these infections caused by fungi are possible to be caused, or these fungi are capable of causing this fungal infections only when they have the capability to cross the resistance barriers of the human body. And thus, they will be capable of establishing infections. So these fungal infections are common. It is not something very serious which doesn't have a cure. It is very common, and it will be there for a short period of time, and it can be treated. And these infections also depend on various environmental and physiological conditions which will promote the development of these fungal infections. And how do these fungi cause infections? Basically, when the spores are inhaled by the humans, they can cause lung infections, or when these spores or when the fungi comes in contact with the skin of the humans, they can cause infections on the skin. So cutaneous mycosis basically refers to infections, fungal infections that is seen on the skin of the humans. When we look at the classification of this cutaneous mycosis, the spelling of mycosis, M-Y-C-O-S-E-S, refers to many fungal infections, and MYCOSIS refers to a single fungal infection. Okay, so that is the difference. So basically, mycosis is classified into three types, that is cutaneous mycosis, subcutaneous mycosis, and systemic mycosis. So cutaneous refers to a scientific term given to anything that you can refer to skin is called as cutaneous. Okay, so cutaneous mycosis is basically a superficial infection of the epidermis layer of the skin or hair and nails. Okay, so it is a superficial infection that is seen only on the upper layer or the outermost layer of the skin. Subcutaneous mycosis is infections that penetrate the epidermis and also the dermis layer of the skin, that is the inner layers of the skin, and it infects the deeper tissues, and that's why it is called as subcutaneous mycosis. Okay, and the next one is systemic mycosis. Systemic generally refers to the whole body. So fungal infections that are spreading throughout the body is referred to as systemic mycosis. Okay. Mycosis can also be called as dermatophytosis because it generally deals with the layers of the skin. So that's why it is also called as dermatophytosis. And these are Here you can see the different types of dermatophytosis that can be seen. So these are basically cutaneous mycosis or superficial fungal infections that are seen on the layer of the skin. Okay, so these are of six types, that is Tinea pedis. Tinea pedis refers to, actually refers to foot. Okay, so this is infections of the foot. So we'll see these infections in detail in the further slides. What are these and how it is caused and what are the symptoms? So just to give an idea, and here Tinea cruris refers to infections of the perineum and scrotum region. And Tinea unguium refers to nail. So infections of the nails, fingernails are referred to as Tinea unguium, and it is also called as onychomycosis. Okay. And Tinea corporis, refers to body, corpus refers to body. So, excuse me. Infections, fungal infections that are seen throughout the, all over the body are referred to as Tinea corporis. Excuse me. Tinea capitis, capit refers to head. So, fungal infections of the head region are called as Tinea capitis. Cultural characteristics of these fungi is similar to that of any other fungi, or these are easily culturable. Any bacteria or fungi can be easily culturable when compared to viruses or protozoans. Okay. So primary isolation media that is used for the isolation of these fungi includes Subrhodes dextrose agar containing cyclohexamide, which is a specific requirement by these cutaneous fungi, and it is incubated at 26 to 28 degrees centigrade for a period of 4 weeks. So this is about the cultural characteristics of this, of these fungi. So when we look at the pathogenicity, as I said earlier, these are very simple fungal infections. So it is very, the pathogenicity is very simple. See, these dermatophytes that are present in the normal environment or in their natural environment like soil gets transferred to the skin either by contact with humans or by mediating contacts with the animals as well. So once it comes in contact with the human skin, these fungi will target the keratinized tissues. Keratinized tissues are the ones, are those tissues that contain keratin as a protein. So this keratinized tissues basically include the skin, hair and the nails. Okay. So these fungi will specifically target these keratinized tissues. And these fungi are capable of secreting, or they have the capability of releasing these enzymes, that is keratinase. So these keratinase will digest the keratin present in the tissues, which can result in breakdown of molecules. So the broken down components as a result of keratinase action is what is used as a nutrition by these fungi. And these fungi, because of these reactions that is happening on the layer of the skin, it can elicit an immune response, which generally results in erythema and pruritus. Erythema refers to reddening of the skin, and pruritus refers to itching of the skin. Okay. The pathogenesis of these fungi is also very simple. So, as I told you in the previous slide, that these keratinases are responsible for digesting the keratin, Apart from keratinases, there are also other proteases that are capable of establishing infection in the keratinized tissues. And apart from this, there are also a class of proteins that are called as lyse M proteins or lyse M domain. So lyse M refers to lysine motif domain. So this domain is also thought to provide anchoring to the extracellular polysaccharides. Like it anchors to the extracellular polysaccharides like peptidoglycan and chitin. And because of this, these fungi can evade the host cell immune response. Because of the presence of this lyse M domain, these fungi can evade or it can escape the host cell immune response. And as the pathogenesis proceeds, the symptoms will manifest in the form of inflammatory reactions due to the presence of the fungal antigens. And because of these inflammatory reactions, the desquamation of the skin occurs, it is also called as skin peeling, and it also causes inflammation on the skin layers. Because of this inflammation and because of the skin peeling, that is desquamation, the dermatophytosis is limited at this stage because the fungi are also washed out of the skin along with the scales of skin. So in a way, the inflammatory responses is trying to wash out the fungal infection and also to remove the infected skin from the body. Coming to the symptoms, so tinea pedis, as I told earlier, pedis refers to infections, fungal infections of the foot, okay? And cruris refers to, it is infection of the proximal, medial, thigh region and also the prium region. It occurs more commonly in case of males and is usually due to spread of the fungus from the feet. So from the feet, it gets transferred to the medial thigh region. And the causative agents of this cruris is trichophyton rubrum and also epidermophyton floccosum. The next one is tinea unguium and tinea corporis and tinea capitis. So you can see it in the slide. Whatever you're seeing here, these are how the infections look like. Tinea pedis, that is in between the toes, you can see the infection. Tinea corporis looks more or less like a ringworm infection. And tinea capitis is infection or redness and inflammation seen on the head region. And unguium is the fungal infection of the nails. So this tinea pedis, that is infection of the foot, is also again caused by trichophyton species, that is trichophyton rubrum and also epidermophyton floccosum. Unguium is also caused by trichophyton rubrum. So trichophyton rubrum is a major fungi that is responsible for majority of these cutaneous mycoses. And tinea corporis, as you see here, it is caused by trichophyton rubrum and also it is caused by gypsum, a species which is referred to as gypsum and also canis. Diagnosis of this fungal infections, one method that can be followed is the Wood's lamp method. So what exactly is this Wood's lamp method? It is basically a wood lamp that uses light of wavelength 365 nanometer. Okay, so when this light is is focused on this infection, if an area of skin is infected, or it can be called as stenia. So when the area of skin which is infected is being focused with this light of 365 nanometer, so the ultraviolet light emitted from these wood lamps, what it does is it causes the fungal elements like the spores and also the hyphae to fluoresce. Okay, so it is basically an ultraviolet light that is being focused on these infections on the tinea, which will help the hyphae and the spores of the fungi present in the infected area to fluoresce, resulting in its detection. Another method is cultural method. So as we discussed in the earlier slide, culturing on Saburo's dextrose agar is another method. So the clinical materials used for these tests include skin scrapings, nail scrapings, and also epilated hairs. So all these clinical material can be used for direct microscopy. So direct microscopy can be performed with these skin scrapings, hairs, or nails to detect the fungi. So generally these specimens are prepared as a wet mount which contains potassium hydroxide solution, that is 10 to 20% aqueous potassium hydroxide. So use of potassium hydroxide helps to dissolve the keratin that is present in the hairs, nails, or skin, and it will allow for the visualization of the hyphae and also the fungal spores. So prophylactic measures is basically to maintain hygiene. Maintaining hygiene is the best way, or it is the best preventive measure for any infections, and very prominently for fungal infections, to keep the skin clean and dry, because dryness is the, or moisture is the main condition, or requirement of moisture is the basic condition of any fungi. Moisture as well as the presence of sugar. So maintaining good hygiene is very important, and also these fungal infections are very contagious, and it is important to wash after touching other people or animals who have been infected with any fungal infections. Treatment as in single infections or single cutaneous lesions can be treated with topical ointments or topical antifungal agents. But if these cutaneous lesions are present on the scalp or on the nails, then it is very ineffective to use topical treatments, because the chances of spreading there is very high, and hence it will need systemic therapy that is needed to cure these conditions. So chronic or widespread dermatophyte infections also require systemic therapy. So some of the antifungals that can be used for the treatment include terbinafine, miconazole, clotrimazole, and also griseofulvin. Griseofulvin can be given orally as well. So these are very simple fungal infections that can be cured with antifungals. But after the treatment of these fungal infections, it is very important to maintain the same proper hygiene, and it is to make sure that the fungal infections do not recur, because they are very contagious. Even if there is a single very minute amount of infection that is persisting, it can spread to other regions of the body as well. Thank you. So this will be the end of your theory syllabus. So whatever doubts you have, you can post it in the post chat. We can discuss there. Referring to this disease or any other disease or any other topics, you can always post it in the post chat. or however you're comfortable, so we can discuss and we can solve them.